did you come up with? What were some of the things that your table discussed and said were commonalities with these different ones? We had, again, the Spurs with Greg Popovich, and then we had the Patriots over here, Belichick, Tom Brady, and we have over here Coach K with Duke University, and we have Alabama, the Rolling Tide with Nick Saban. What did you guys say were some of the things that these had in common? This table.
Stable leadership.
Stable leadership. Good. What else did you guys come up with on this table?
National championship.
These were champions. Good. What else? This table.
They have been able to recreate that continually.
They've been able to repeat it continuously. Thank you. Others on this table?
They have a process in place.
They have systems in place. Good. Over here.
Well, they have stable leadership and all that other stuff, but they have great culture.
Stable leadership, and they have great coaches.
They also have great talent.
And they have great talent. Good. Let me get one more. And a great culture around those, okay? Great. These are all some recipes that we can benefit from on a number of levels, not just with grants, but in particular, as we discussed today with grants, you guys have already pointed out some of the important things. These are champions. And if your organization is going to be a champion organization, if your organization is going to get more funding, it has to become a champion in these areas of getting funding. They also, as you guys have pointed out, have great coaches that have coached them in these areas towards success. They have systems that help to make it happen over and over and over again. And it's the same way in funding. Those organizations that have figured out the recipe, that have nurtured their talent, that have cultivated a culture of getting funding, tend to get more funding than the rest. In fact, many of you have heard of the 80-20 rule. We've heard about this rule where basically there was basically this Italian economist that came up and realized that 80% of the income of Italy was received by 20%. That whole 80-20 rule has kind of carried over in a number of other areas. In fact, the 80-20 rule actually carries over in production. Typically, 20% is doing what's producing the vast results. And in a similar way, 20% of society tends to be doing well. 80% not so well. And if we were to break down that 20% and look at it even closer, 1% of our society is doing extremely well. Of that 20%. And of that 20%, 5% is doing, you know, very well. And then of that number, about 14% is still doing moderately well. And then again, of that 80%, 80% not doing so well. This is also very true as it relates to funding and grant funding. And so when we look at it, we've got to ask ourselves and make it our task as a school district to say, what does our school district need to do so that we can tap into and become one of the top 20 and then go from there to being a part of the top 5 and then to being a part of the top 1% that's securing funding. But there is one big problem. Okay? One big problem. Will you stand up for a second? That's a good one. Please stand up for a second. Come with me for one second. Come with me one second. You three. Here's the problem. Just turn this way for a second. Please get that for a second. Get that. There you go. You get that for a second. There you go. Get that. Okay. There you go. You get that. Please put that on. Okay. Now, on the count of three, please turn around. On the count of three, one, two, some of us a little slower. One, two, three, please turn around. Here's the problem. There are thieves in your house. That's the problem.
Thanks, Rodney.
Yeah. You know, and the problem is this. There are thieves right now. I'm not saying that they're going to come. I'm not saying they might come one day. I'm saying they're already there. There's thieves in your house right now where you are losing funding right now that you could possibly be getting, but because these thieves have not been identified, the funding continues to go out, okay? Now, let's talk about these thieves. Now, for a second, I know the thieves are trying to get away. Okay, right now, okay. Now, here's the thing. Until your district decides that it's going to arrest the thieves and capture those thieves so you can keep more funding in your district, then money is going to continue to leak out. Let's thank our thieves for a second. Just give them a big hand clap real quick. Thank you. Now, these are some of the most corroborative thieves. Now, let me ask you a quick question. Now, if you have thieves in your house, are we going to say, oh, hey, thieves, come on in. Just grab a seat. Let's have dinner. Let's talk it over. No, we don't do that. We arrest them. We get them out. So get out of here. All right. Here we go. Here's the deal. Your district must remove the thieves to get the maximum success. It's going to have to remove the thieves. There's an African proverb that says, where there is no enemy within, the enemies without cannot hurt you. So we got to be very intentional about removing the thieves. And I want to share with you some of those thieves today that are currently preventing more monies from coming to your district. And I want to call your attention to it. You'll see these in your handouts. You'll find them inside of your packets. I believe it's on the left-hand side of your packet. You'll see the PowerPoint handouts for you. But I want to point out real quickly, I said 10, but I'm going to actually give you two more. The first enemy that is a big problem that many of our districts have is, first, many are only seeking grants from limited sources. Okay? They're seeking grants only from a limited number of sources. Think about it. The more sources that you begin to tap into, the more funding that can actually come your way. The second big problem is this. Most districts are not applying as much as possible to the right funders. Okay? So if there were 20 opportunities that we had the potential of applying for grants to, but we only applied for 3 opportunities, again, do the math. The odds are not in your favor. So we want to apply to the right funders more often. A third big problem that a lot of districts have is that they're unaware of the full range of grant opportunities. The opportunities have not been fully explored. I'm going to say it again. Let me see what that's happened. The opportunities have not been fully explored. Okay. And that's what's happening in a lot of cases. So if the opportunities haven't been explored, and if you haven't done an inventory to look at what are your programs, what are the opportunities that we could possibly apply for, then again, there's a leakage there, and we want to fix that leakage. Here's another big problem that a lot of districts are having as well. Many of them are really developing relational equity in their grant process. They might have a grant writer, they may have a contracted grant writer, but they've totally neglected the opportunities that they have to cultivate the relational aspect to help bring in more funding. And the bottom line is this: people give to people, okay? It's a people's game. So people give to people, even in grants. So if we have not cultivated the relational aspect, then we are missing a huge opportunity to bring in more funds our way. And while we're at this point, I want to share this with you. Here's a challenge. Many of us in this room have been trained to be educators and administrators, okay? And then what happens, you come in and then you're tossed into having not only to be an educational administrator, but then when you have these budget and shortfalls, now the board is looking at you saying, bring in the money. And you're like, bring in the money? Where did they teach me this in school. Nowhere. Most have not been trained on how to bring funds in. And so you haven't, like we saw in the earlier picture, really been properly developed in that area. So that's where oftentimes the shortfall begins to take place. Let's continue to look and take a look at some of the other challenges that are big problems that keep funding from coming our way. We also, number five, have little or no grant systems in place. Think about it earlier. We saw the systems that were some of the coaches had. Now, the Spurs, I believe, for those of you that keep up with basketball, the Spurs lost Tim Duncan last year. He retired. But guess what? Because the coach is a great coach and he has great systems, they're still doing extremely well. Think about the beginning of the season where Tom Brady was, what, how many games was he out this year? Four games. Where did they go? They went what? 3-1. Great, probably one of the greatest coaches, greatest quarterbacks ever, pulled out of the system and is still working well. So we want to make sure that we get the proper systems in place so that we can keep the funding coming our way. If we have no systems, then that impacts our funding. In addition to that, many have poorly construed grant development plans, if any at all. Ask yourself, what is our grant development plan? Oftentimes that is more like, hey, go find some grants and see if we qualify. And that's not really a system. And what I want to encourage you to do is to say, maybe our district should get a grant coordinator and help to orchestrate and coordinate our grant efforts. That begins to be more of a system, more of a team approach that we've got to also take. A couple other things that we want to take a look at that impacts and are big problems as well. Many districts don't have well-defined roles of leadership for winning grants. Again, it kind of points back to that big problem where no one has really trained us and taught us on how to do this part. In addition to that, there's a lack of awareness of grant development best practices. And in addition, there's a limited number of schools that are pursuing grants in your district. Now, think about this. You may have a district that maybe has a number of schools in it, but I know that some districts only have grant development taking place at the central office. That becomes a challenge because your school is now limiting the number of grants that it could possibly get. And if you had more of the schools within your district that were pursuing grants, now you have the possibilities of more funding coming in from those individual schools. A few other problems that we want to look at that are huge problems. Also, there are a limited number of schools pursuing grants in your district and no concrete goals and objectives written for your grant pursuit. So typically, we just recently did a conference that was in Vegas that was for educational schools, the Education Grants Conference. And at that conference, we had many different schools and school districts that were represented. I asked a question about the systems, how many of them had systems, how many of them had written goals, about how much funding they wanted to secure that year. Very few hands went up. And so many of the grant writers that even came, along with some of their superintendents, basically made mention, hey, we don't have a system in place. I'm just going out the grants. And so that's something that we want to definitely fix. Let me give you these last few, and then I want to give you some pointed takeaways that we can learn in a case study here. Also, many have poorly ran grant writing team meetings, if any at all. As a superintendent, it would behoove you to have meetings to discuss what are our grant efforts. And there should really be a grant development team in place. And on that team, you should be on that team along with your grant coordinators, our grant writers, as well as a few other key members. And it should be a coordinated effort. Let me share a couple other things. Here's another big problem. There's a lack of empowerment throughout the district to pursue grants. So these are some big problems that I would say would be immediate problems that you would want to address to help to stop the leakage. Now, let's take a look here. If we could stop this big problem, because these here are the thieves, and say, okay, great, what do we need to become a magnet to attract more funding? If we could address these issues, then your school can become more of a grant money magnet. And what we want to do is become more magnetically attractive to funders. And there are some things that we can do to help do that. One of the things Terry made mention of a little earlier as he was talking and giving his presentation, and that is simply telling your district's story better. Telling your district's story better. You want to ask yourself, how are we currently telling our story and what story is out there about us? We want to control that story and help to try to put it out there in such a way that we become more attractive to funders. If we don't address this issue, we find that we are be shooting ourselves in the foot. I want to share with you one superintendent's $100,000 mistake, okay? His $100,000 mistake. I recently talked to a superintendent on the phone, and he had shared with me that he was fairly new to the district. I think he was in his second year at this particular district, and he had spent nearly $100,000 for some grant writing services. And that would be okay, but the only problem was he got back $30,000 of value. Big problem, okay? That's not adding up quite well, okay? If he had invested that amount of money and got back anything over that, I would be like, okay, pretty good. But to go under that is pretty bad. I think districts, if they could take the notation and say, okay, great, where are we investing into? If he would have taken even a portion of that funding and then invested it into his staff or to the various schools within that district to empower them, would probably have been a much better investment, because now you're training up an army of people to pursue funding. And when you do so, you can find some very interesting things that can happen. I want to share with you inside of your packet, there is one case study. I'd like for you to take a look at it right now. It's on the left-hand side of your packet at the last page, and there's a group in Kelowna. I'd like for you to take a moment right now to just look at that story, and you'll find something really interesting that takes place in Kelowna. I want to give you about a minute and a half to just read through this story, and then we're going to discuss this. I want you to discuss it real quickly on your table, what you found interesting about this group in Kelowna, Iowa. So let's take about a minute and a half to read through this. Let me get some of the highlights of what your table found interesting. What were some of the highlights? Some of the highlights that your table found interesting. What did you guys come up with?
You've almost established a culture for teachers to go for.
They established the culture for teachers to pursue funding. This is a huge one, because oftentimes we have resources that we are completely overlooking, okay? So what happens when your teachers, your principals, and your schools within your districts are empowered to pursue funding themselves? And at the district level, you have somebody helping to coordinate those efforts and assist them and aid them. Think about it. If your school district has 30 schools in it, for instance, now you have 30 schools pursuing grants collectively. This school was empowered, and this little, listen, this place, what was the population again? What? 2,000, it was a small school district.
250 students.
And yet they bought in, what, over some $1 million over the course of those 3 years? What else did you guys find interesting as you discussed this?
Well, the reason it's $1 million is the $885,000 grant.
They got a large one. So they got a large state federal grant as well. So you had small grants that were maybe being pursued more from the foundation level, and then they had this huge one that was secured as well. Good. What else did you discuss that stood out to you?
Well, we didn't discuss this at the table, but, you know, success breeds success. So they had to start with some grants that weren't that big, just to get the experience and understand the know-how behind achieving a winning grant.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It started small, and then as time continued, it grew in size. And that's very typical with funding. And it's also it helps you to become more magnetic because with funding, the bottom line with funding, funders want to know that they're not funding all your fund. It's no fun to fund all your fund, okay? I know it's a simple statement, but I'm going to say it again. It's no fun to fund all of your fund. And when districts make themselves more attractive, where they see, when other funders see that you're getting funding from other sources, that makes you more attractive to the funders as well. Thank you.
True. We have the same in.
You have the same what now?
Well, what you just said is very true. When you begin to get grants and when you begin to get funding, there are other people that start calling and say, what's going on? We just had that with the Verizon Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
We just got word of about a $3 million grant to my district that we were not even expecting. But it's because of what the network, whatever it is, that the people know. And in our particular case, it has to do with innovation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's very
great.
True.
That's great. And schools could do, districts could be do a better job of once you get grant funding.
Advertise it.
Exactly. Promote it. We're so thankful to be getting this grant from so-and-so and so-and-so and putting it out there so that others know, because again, it's almost like, I like to say it like this, funders have a sixth grade mentality. Remember when you were in sixth grade, your friend called you, told you they're going to be having a birthday party, and they said, hey, I may be having this birthday party, why don't you come over? What did you want to know?
Where it is, when it is, and can I be there?
Exactly. Yeah, where it is, when is it? And what did you say?
Who else is coming?
And who else is going to be at this party? Because depending on who else is going to be at this party, it's going to help me to determine if I want to come to the party. And that's a classic example of what you just pointed out as well. When funders start knowing that, you become more attracted to the funders. So these are system type of issues that I want to encourage your district to look at, because when you do so, you can begin to be attract more funding. The other thing I would say as I get ready to conclude and wrap up is if your district can get trained and then say, okay, great, what do we need to do? How do we build these systems? How do we put these systems in place? And then empower your schools to go out the funding, then you'll find more funding coming your way. I want to point out a couple things to you. Here's some people. Here's one young lady that came into one of our trainings. She knew doodly squat about grant writing. Her name was Catherine Timmerbolt. She was bumping her head up against the wall, but she got the systems that we talked about and turned that into $400,000 within 6 months for her school at the Brim Center. She used this system, the information in this system. We have this system in the back. It's an online piece I'll tell you about that you can access. And it's a great way to train multiple people within your district. And that is a person in the back if you're interested in finding out more information about possibly getting that on today. Here's another young lady, Nikki. She was familiar with grant management, didn't know a thing about grant writing, took the information, and within her first year secured $4 million for her organization. And that $4 million, you see 2.5 there in 9 months. I talked to her later on that year she ended up securing $4 million. Here's another young guy with his city that helped to raise $4 million, and this was within 1 year. The bottom line is this, it takes time. However, you want to get the systems in place and you want to get the right information to pursue from the right funders. This is another young lady, she just wrote me last week, let me know that she secured $57,000 for her organization in the Dallas area. So the bottom line is, I want to encourage you to get systems. We have an event that's going to be taking place real soon. We have like 91 seats still left. That's going to be taking place in September. That's going to be on the 27th and the 28th, the Educational Grants Conference. Now, this is not a grant writing conference where you're going to be learning about grant writing. That system I showed you earlier addresses that. This conference is going to be addressing systems and helping your organization to get the right systems in place. Our very own Don Harper is going to be there with us. He's going to be sharing some insight. And I just talked briefly with Terry before he left. to discuss with the possibilities of helping districts to tell a better story. And he's going to be possibly joining us for that as well. But Dunn will definitely be there. I want to encourage your district to possibly come, to possibly bring not just one person, but to bring a team, two or three people that can come, that can work on getting your systems in place for your grant development efforts. That's going to be taking place on September the 27th and 28th. It's going to be at San Diego State University. So I know those of you that just hate coming out to California, it's going to be at San Diego State University. So I invite you to join us there. Also, finally, as I get ready to conclude, we have about 9 schools this year that we still are able to go to, where we take our training and we train your school district. So if your school thinks that it may be interested, I want to give you a number. The number is not in the packet, but I want to give you a number. And if your school is interested in possibly being one of those 9, I want to encourage you to simply fax in, have someone from your organization to fax in a statement of interest, and we will get back to you in regards to that. But the number is 1-888-293-0284. And that's the main telephone number. Let me get the fax number for you, because the fax will go to a different place. You know what? If you just call that number and ask for the fax number, they'll give you the fax number for it. But if your school is interested in being one of those 9, we'll be happy to possibly consider your school as one of those potential ones. What they will do, just so you know, is send you back an application in regards to that, and then we will go from there. I want to be fair, because I know a number of you may be interested in that. So please know that after this session, I won't be able to talk to you about going to your school, because there's a whole process for that. But if you'll call that number and contact them, we'll be happy to possibly connect with you in that regard. I want to now thank you guys for your time and see if there are any questions that we may have for you guys. And if so, I'd be happy to address them.
Anybody have a quick question?
Yes, the San Diego, right now the cost is $14.95 for that. I think it that's a super early bird special. The regular rate is $19.97.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.